How's it going, guys? My name is Zach with the movie Castle, and today we're going to be talking about The Me You Love in the Dark. This is a 5-issue miniseries from Image Comics there, and it's a, you know, supernatural horror story, but it, you know, is more a character study, a study on this relationship. And it's not, you know, your stereotypical horror tropes, although, of course, by the end of this, it does get pretty horrific, and there is a bunch of crazy supernatural monster stuff in there. So it does get to there, but that's not really the focus of this comic. This comic's about this painter girl named Ro, who's had some success, but when she's successful, she's run out of vision and ambition, and she doesn't really know what she wants to paint anymore, so she goes to this nice old haunted house, and she thinks it's just a story, right? But she's going to meet this supernatural being, you know, at first she calls it a ghost, but it's something bigger and scarier and more powerful than you might think. And, you know, she's at a bad place in her life, and she develops a relationship with this, and, you know, at first it seems to go well, but you really do see that there is a poison deep down in the center of this relationship, and we get to study, you know, how it falls apart, and you get to really analyze what these two characters meant to each other, and it is a pretty interesting story there, and I really did like that. You know, it's only 5 issues. It's a miniseries, so it's pretty, you know, to the point, you know, not a whole ton of filler. And by being able to do a story that's just a mini-series, you don't have to worry about, you know, finding artificial ways to keep this series going on for forever. So I like that it got to go in and tell the story it wanted to tell and not have to worry about, you know, if it was going to be a 26-issue book, how do we fill up all that screen time? Let's go ahead and take a look at the credits. As I always say, credit where credit's due. And they have them on the inside of the cover under this picture of the house she's staying in. And we see the story is by Skottie Young with art by Jorge Corona. And he was the same guy that did the Big Trouble in Little China Old Man Jack art. Pretty cool to see him here. This is some really fun art from this guy. Colors by Jean Francis Bellew. I'm not 100% sure how to pronounce that, but really good colors in the book. I really do love this art style. And of course, Nate Pecos of Blambot, who seems to do almost all of the lettering these days. But let's go ahead and take a little bit more specific look at that plot. I'm not going to be doing any major spoilers, but I do want to say my piece on a few of the plot points and make sure you guys have a basic understanding as to what this story is about. But yeah, no major spoilers. I'll keep it primarily to issues 1 and 2, but there's a quick page I want to show you from 3, but we'll keep 4 and 5 off limits. But let's take a little bit more of a look at that story. We open up with Ro here, and she is trying to get away from it all and find a new source of inspiration for her paintings. And she finds this big old house, and the realtor's like, look, certain people have said that they've felt a presence in that house. It's purported to be haunted. Maybe you don't want it. And she goes, ooh, haunted. That's actually really interesting. Maybe I really do want this house. And you get this really fun double page spread to get our first look at the house there. But yeah, good old classically styled haunted house. But she goes in there and she starts to work a bit. And one thing with this book, and it really, you know, is kind of a minor detail, but she, you know, plays music on these old vinyl records, and the music comes out looking like this. And I really do love this, this sort of artistic motif of the music looking like this weird white line here. It's, you know, not just your standard music notes, and I really do like how that works, but she's in the habit of, you know, drinking wine and trying to paint, but she really does feel uninspired at the moment, and she'll routinely talk to the ghost, you know, just make jokes like, oh, hey, there's supposed to be a ghost in the studio, and she goes, hey, you know, the least you could do is start my record player and pour my wine for me. But she, you know, starts to make jokes, you know, talking to the house's ghost, even though she doesn't actually see anything. But of course, you know, you get one day, a little bit later, she goes into the studio and finds the wine already poured, the record already going, and she's like, am I drinking too much? I don't remember doing any of this. And, you know, her agent calls her and tells her that, you know, she really needs to be getting those paintings ready. You see, she was young, she was ambitious, and she was really able to paint through a lot of that back when she was really hungry, but now that she's successful, her life has kind of become dull, and she doesn't really know who she is or what she wants, and in turn, it's really hard to paint, you know, especially, man, you know, abstract art, really hard to, you know, get something down right when there are, you know, no set in stone rules, you know? So yeah, she's getting pretty frustrated, and she eventually says to the ghost, hey, should I quit? And the ghost goes, no, you shouldn't. And that's where she first, you know, hears this voice in the house. And she hears for the first and, you know, foremost time that there's definitely a spirit here. And of course, she runs out of the house. She's all panicky at first. But, you know, she goes back in. She thinks, okay, you know, I just heard something. There's no way there was something really here. And she's like, you know, are you a real ghost or am I just going crazy? And the ghost is like, I don't know if you're crazy or not, but I'm definitely real. And the two start to talk to each other. And at first, the spirit's very polite. And, you know, she's looking for something new. She's looking for something interesting. And she starts talking to the spirit. You know, she is just really mesmerized by this new and interesting thing. And it's something she very much feels like she needs at the moment. And you do get, especially early on in the book, a little bit of glimpses of them, like there's just his legs and maybe you'll see a hand later, but you know, very much little glimpses, but you don't really see him, you know. So they start to talk, and she's very happy that she has a new friend, that something interesting in the world is happening to her, but he of course makes a request right off the bat, and he goes, I don't like the light. Can you turn off all the lights and light the room by candlelight? Which is going to create this great motif for the book, and also explains the title, The Me You Love in the Dark. So she's quite often alone, working, surrounded by candlelight, and you get lots of these really nice, warm blues and oranges there, you know? And the book is not afraid to, like look at this page where there's no dialogue, you know, there doesn't necessarily need to be. There's none of that overly explaining stuff like, and then I was painting and I felt this, you know. So there is several pages in these issues where, you know, if there's no need for dialogue, you know, there might just be the little line of music and that's it, if anything, you know. So I really do love that this book is okay and comfortable with silence on the page and not having to overly explain anything there. But you know, also, in addition to really just the great art, this really is a good story about a relationship, you know, the spirit that didn't have anybody and the girl that was looking for someone, and you can see why they were drawn to each other and what kicks off this relationship. But of course, there's going to be a part of the relationship that's poisoned, that's bad, and that's going to, you know, we all know this is a horror story. It's going to turn quite bad at the end, and you get to study and see how this relationship falls apart. But what I do like, too, is it's not just, you know, the main character, the girl, isn't, you know, a weak person. She's very strong, and she'll stand up for what she wants, and the only reason she let it go on so far is because it was something that she wanted. She liked this new and interesting relationship. She wasn't bullied into it. She's just choosing to grab onto something and doesn't realize how out of control it's gotten until way too late. But yeah, there's a scene I wanted to show you. Her on the couch watching a movie with this vague shadowy figure. That's actually one of the times you get to see more of him during the early book. But yeah, just, you know, you and your, you know, agent, you know, Lovecraftian tear sitting on the couch watching a movie, you know. But it was really fun, and, you know, being only 5 issues, it really kept it on plot. You know, it kept it to what it should be focused on. It kept it to just the relationship study, you know. And I have to think, if you were going to turn this into something else, like a TV series or a movie, you'd have to throw in them going on weird little adventures and subplots, you know? Like, there's no, then me and the ghost did this, or then me and the ghost did this wacky adventure, you know? There's none of that, and it's really focused on just the emotional through line there. So I really do like that they were able to, you know, tell a story in 5 issues that was meant to be in 5 issues. And overall, it came out really cool. Before we leave, let's go ahead and give you guys a closer look at these covers. They all have a very similar motif. At the top, you get the house, and then you get this big title going through the center. And here you see Ro, your main character, and then the little hands coming towards the painting. So issue 1, a really nice and classic cover. Then you have issue 2. And it's the same motif, house on top, big title, but it's the creature with his famous candlelight from the story there. So, keeping the same motif and changing it on. Here, the house, warm summer day, yellow for the title, and the music with her reflection in her glasses there. This one, she's breaking her wine cup. The house has snow on it, and here's the final big terror cover with a bunch of eyes, and the house is enraged and stuff, you know. So, a very cool cover motif for this series, and I really did like it. Overall, it's really fun. If you're looking for something that's like more traditional straight terror, that's not really what this is, but it's taking horror and using it to do a good character study, and using it to do a good study and analysis of this relationship. And it's short and focused and to the point, and I really do love that art style, the character design with these really big glasses here. I really do love the art and the colors in this book, and that cool music motif, which is all the back covers are the music motif there. So I really did like that. You know, as far as flaws, the one thing is this story, it does take place over the course of about a year, but you really feel like it could have taken place in like a week, you know? Because it is short, you don't get the sense that massive amount of time is going on. So I feel like maybe there might have been a way to expand it a little more and sell that time was traveling at a longer rate, you know? Because you don't really notice until they mention, you know, oh, it's Christmas now. You don't really get the sense of just how long the story took. But yeah, it's about a year for this story to take place. And you don't necessarily get that because it feels like just a couple weeks. But that's really just a nitpick. That's really just a minor thing. Overall, I thought this book was really fun. And, you know, it really fun to read it and then discuss the relationships. Because, you know, it is a very abnormal relationship. Someone getting excited by something really extra dimensional. So I really did like that motif, and overall a really fun miniseries with really, really great art. Anyway, to everyone who's watched so far, thank you for watching. To everyone who's liked and subscribed, thank you. You really are helping the channel out. I'll leave a relevant playlist on the bottom. If you guys want to see more, you can click there and see more. Should be a bunch more comics in that playlist. But anyway, have a good day. I'll see you guys again very, very soon. Relevant playlist on the bottom. Have a good day now.